I'm your host, Harrison.
Bang, 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 bang.
Honestly, I think I can fuck with a motherfucker like you.
Ooh, gee.
See, I don't like a motherfucker that be all on this.
It's the 81 and 92 podcast, where we always keep it 100.
Show me one!
You know how we do. Ooh, gee. Yo, 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 what's up, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the 8 More Than 92 podcast, where we always keep it 100. I am your host, Harrison, and I am joined today by my brother from another doing the damn thing, Thwizzle, money-making Mitch. Welcome back to the show today.
What's up, bro?
Bang, bang. Bring him in one more time. One more because the nigga missed. All right.
This nigga here.
What's good, my guy? Welcome back.
What's up, bro, man? Happy to be back. Appreciate you.
Appreciate you for coming with us, fucking with the gang gang. You know, you are like honorary 8 More Than 92 podcast family at this point. So I don't even consider you a guest. I consider you one of the peoples pulling up as I
I ain't gotta ask the shit in the bathroom no more.
You said you ain't gotta ask shit in the bathroom no more?
Exactly.
Oh, okay. That's a weird thing. You should always still ask the shit in somebody's bathroom if it ain't
I'm not company no more. I'm taking the shit wherever I'm at.
Oh, okay. Sure. Nasty. Niggas don't wash their hands either, but that's some indie
shit. I wash my hands.
That's some scary shit. That Michael Jackson getting beat by Joe Jackson shit. But you know, it's been a while since you've been on, man. So go ahead while I fix my and put my headphones on. Tell everybody what you've been up to, man. How you been?
Man, I'm been enjoying fatherhood, man. Stay at home dad, you know what I'm saying? With my son full time. Working from home and then working at night while his mom at home. So That's what I've been up to, bro. Son 9 months old, about to be 10 months. You know what I'm saying?
How's fatherhood changed you prior to you being pregnant? What's your view on things?
I won't say it changed me at all. I'll say that it made me more of like who I already was. You know what I'm saying? I'm just head of the household. You know what I'm saying? I'll say it's just got me more serious, like about
the mixtapes.
About it's just like I got a reason for not wanting to, you know what I'm saying, be outside. Cause I was already at home, buddy. Now I got a reason to stay at home.
You know, I mean, as a father myself and who had both parents in his life, I know my motivation raising and being active in my son's life. Because, I mean, I had two parents. Why would I rob him of that opportunity? But
exactly.
I've always wanted, I mean, you probably might answer the same way, but I wanted to ask somebody else, you know, a lot of people in our generation are now kind of still, it still happens, but breaking that curse of trend of not being actively involved in their kids' life. So I think both your parents are married.
Yeah.
Okay. So what was your motivation for being a good father? Because in my case, excuse me for the burp. In my case, because of the relationship I had with mine, I wanted to be the complete opposite. So even though I was raised, you know what I'm saying, I had motivation to do the opposite of how I was. But everybody I've seen in your family is very close-knit.
Yeah.
So for somebody who was raised traditional, has a father that he looks up to and considers a role model, what is your motivation to be a good father?
For the simple fact that my dad was always there. I'm not going to sit here in front like me and my dad always got along. You know what I'm saying? But I can't say a single time where I didn't have him, you know what I'm saying? Good or bad. And then, shoot, just showing my son's mom that all men ain't the same. You know what I'm saying? Everybody ain't just going up and leave. You know what I'm saying? Regardless of whatever's going on. Me and her work through everything. But my motivation was being the solid man that my dad is and just being a solid man to my woman. You know what I'm saying?
I got you. And those are kind of things that you would kind of teach your son.
Absolutely.
Before. I always say with the first kid, you know, you kind of see what you did wrong. I'm sorry, you maybe overdo everything, and by the time you get to the second kid, you may be kind of chilled out because you see what works and what didn't work.
Yeah.
Always wonder for you, what is it that you want your son to be?
I want him to be whatever he want to be. I was never pressured to be no athlete. I was never pressured to be no scholar or anything like that from my parents or from my big brothers, because my big brothers, you know what I'm saying, are examples for fathers too. I was never pressured. So I'm going to let him choose what he want to choose. Now, is he going to do what I want him to do as a kid? Is he going to be in every single sport and do whatever, like in church and everything like that? Yeah. But whatever he decides is ultimately up to him. He can be an artist. He can be an athlete. He can be, you know, a politician if he wanted to. But as long as he's sure about himself and not being influenced by anybody on the outside, then I'm okay with it.
So you didn't grow up in like a struggling setting, and this is actually, I'm gonna switch some topics around, so we're gonna jump one and put it back up. You didn't actually grow up in like the hardest setting, but you still knew how to work hard because what your parents instilled with you, right?
No, we grew up hard. We didn't have it easy, like, you know what I'm saying? Just because you got both parents don't mean you got it easy.
I mean, you didn't grow up like poor.
We had everything we needed.
Okay.
I'll say that.
So, and this is a reason why I said it, because it's going to lead into the topic that we're going to. When you are better off than what you may have been younger, even if your parents, you know, were doing what they could, got better as you got older, how do you raise a kid to have that same motivation, that same drive and hunger that you have for yourself? How do you get him to have that hunger when he may not see his parents struggling? He do this, you know what I'm saying? Like, what are you going to do to instill that go get it in it that you were instilled with, even while your parents were doing what they were doing to provide? Like you said, you weren't gone without, you still had a hunger and drive, because, you know, you see a lot of times with kids who are better off than their parents were, they don't have that same get it from the mud mentality, you know?
I would say that he's going to have everything that he wants, but he's going to have to earn his way into keeping it. You know what I'm saying? Like, I won't rob him of his childhood because he's a kid. So, like, if he says he wants something, all right, cool, you can have it. But if you go off the rails, if you start slacking off and, you know what I'm saying, school or anything like that, it's going to get taken away, because that's what happened to us as a kid. Like, if we didn't have it because we couldn't have it, that was one thing. But if we had it and then we did wrong or anything like that, it was taken away from us. You know what I'm saying? So it's just like, you know, some teachers on the first day of school, they'll say you start the class with an A. And if you don't do your work or if you don't keep up with it, then your A drops. I'm gonna have the same mentality.
Okay. So you want to make sure, like I said, you instill those like grit type mentalities.
Yeah.
I'm just going to jump us into our first topic. We're moving them around a little bit. Wanted to talk about black people using nepotism, right? I seen two instances. One of them, well, I seen one incident, but the other incident is more of, you know, me talking to people and talking to somebody about sports. But the first one, Idris Elba had a movie come out and his daughter auditioned for the film. Mm-hmm. And his daughter was him, and it was Idris Elba and Will Packer. And for the movie, Idris' daughter auditioned for him. Now, Idris' daughter didn't get the part, but, you know, they said it made her better. He said he wanted her to audition. I guess he wanted her to go through the struggles, because that's not always going to be the case that you luck up and have your dad. You know, you want to make sure that you can get it on your own. And right. So they just think that she was ready for the part, even if she was his daughter. And so I wanted to get it, but people had a problem with it. They were saying black people don't do enough to like look out for ourselves when it comes to nepotism and bringing things into, when it comes to helping ourselves get into better positions like white people do.
Right.
And my caveat to that was, if you go to look at some of these AAU games or football or anything, the next generation of basketball players have an unfair advantage to a lot of people whose parents didn't play in the league.
Yeah.
And because you got somebody like Dwayne Wade, he owns the Utah Jazz. So he got his son in the G League. You got somebody like LeBron is letting his sons train with NBA professional trainers. It's right. Nobody in high school that's going to get me better than Tim Grover is going to get Bronny and Bryce. Exactly. You know, so I want to know, what's your stance on nepotism in the Black community? How do you feel on it?
I would say, as far as the Idris Elba thing, I agree with that. Like, because it's an art form. You know what I'm saying? Acting is an art form. Making films is an art form. And some of the greats got it out the mud, just like, you know what I'm saying, everybody else. So I would say it's good and bad. It's good that I'll say it's bad from an objective standpoint, because, you know, what if she really wanted that part and you had the power to make it happen? You know what I'm saying? You could have just given it to her. But on the other side of that, you still got her in that room. You still got her in front of that camera and in front of those directors or screenwriters or whoever. You know what I'm saying? So now they know what her level of talent is and, you know, what she can improve on. Ultimately, she's going to get better from that, just because, like I said, her dad is Idris Elba. So they're not just going to, you know what I'm saying, dog her or anything like that. Like, because of who her dad is, they're going to give her that advice. They're going to take that time to make her better if that's what she really wants to do. Far as, like, the athletes and everything, hell yeah. If that's my kid and I'm, you know, one of the most popular athletes in the world, I'm going to put them with the guys that make me better. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to put them with those coaches that, you know, other people don't have access to. But I'm also going to, you know, make sure that my kid appreciates that too, and also bring him around the people that don't have that. Because especially on the athlete standpoint, usually the best athletes got it out the mud. You know what I'm saying? Bron came from a single parent household, didn't have his dad in his life, you know what I'm saying, from the Midwest, and is one of the greatest athletes of all time. So and he only got better. So why not put your kids in front of, you know, the people that's going to help them get better?
I agree with that. My stance on it is it's like people talking about generational wealth from their parents. Yeah. We're the generation that's going to create generational wealth, not them. Exactly. It just wasn't sustainable at the time for us. And I think a lot of people just kind of get sidetracked, like, it's this thing. It was what you were saying earlier, what I was asking you earlier about, you know, getting some for cash and him having not to work as hard. And so he is not appreciative of the things that you do for him, because he doesn't realize what the sacrifice you had to do prior to yourself, when, you know, like, you wouldn't even think to go to the store and ask for something if y'all couldn't afford it. You know what I'm saying? But these kids are on it. It's kind of like when I see T.I.'s son, his major, the one that's always in trouble.
I think that's King, the one that's in trouble.
And King fighting, King cussing, King got tattoos on his neck, and nobody's doubting, like, King being tough.
Yeah.
But you ain't have to do nothing what your father had to do. And right. I think that's one of the things that, like, you know, fall to Idris. I don't have a problem with that, because just like we were saying earlier, you have to sometimes work to get something.
Yeah.
And in Idris's case, what if he's not there? Are you going to feel a way if somebody else made you act for it or do anything more? If he's going to hold you to a standard, then you know you won't take it from anybody else, because even your dad wouldn't give it to you. Now, you have the instances where you have, like, Tyler Perry's who look out for Black people, and it is nepotism. But we just have to realize, I feel like we're behind the track on where white people got a head start, but we have to realize where we're beneficial at and where we play a piece to what happens for the next generation. And shout out to my man Dolomite for Too Much Game Podcast. He said this: how can somebody tell you what to do with credit, a house, anything, if they never had that shit themselves?
Right.
Now I have properties, and my dad got one, but he can't, my mom didn't. So, you know, she can't tell me if I'm doing something right or wrong for something she didn't do. She can advise me and things like that, but you can't sit there and tell people something that you aren't doing or that you've never done, because it's hard to take your advice. A lot of times, and that goes to the niggas out there commenting on Pinterest. Y'all niggas ain't in the acting world. So how are you going to sit there and tell somebody what they doing? Like bitch, why am I going to listen to Tommy Nuts 887 with an egg on his thing telling me how to get my daughter in? Yet we have a date with her, and because I'm cool with Will Packer, he's going to look out for her for a different role. Now, if you can't even play your own, you can't even play the daughter to your own daddy, that should really open your eyes. Right. I got a long way to go. If you can't even typecast yourself, like even look what Jamie Foxx did with his daughter. He put her, they had that boo-boo ass show, like every time it came on.
Oh shit. Here we go again.
I watched like two episodes of it, maybe.
Not turn that shit off. Like I said, but he put her in positions to be executive producers because she watched the show. Kevin Hart does the same thing with Heaven. I think that's her name. And so it's just like you put your people in positions, but she wants to act. It's a hard business. Everybody ain't the Wayans.
Yeah.
And we just put. Go ahead.
No. Another thing I was going to say is like my kid will never have to work hard for what I didn't have growing up. But he is going to have to work hard for what he wants personally. You know what I'm saying? If I see that he wants something that I didn't have, cool, I'm going to give it to him. Or that I had to struggle to get, cool, I'm going to give it to him because I'm in that position. But if it's something that he just wants, you know what I'm saying? All right, cool. What you got to do to get it? All right, go get it. Because at the same time, we also have the disadvantage of not always being taken seriously as black people. You know what I'm saying? Don't nobody really talk about it, about white people, you know what I'm saying, being put in position by their parents because it's white people, they're the majority. We the minority. So, and then like things like affirmative action and everything, like they already talk down about us, you know what I'm saying, as far as that goes. Well, you only have it because of this. Nah, my kid is gonna work for what he wants. You know what I'm saying? If I didn't have it, he can get it from me. But if it's something that I didn't have, and that I don't have now, he's gonna learn how to get it out the mud. I'm gonna do my best to put him in the right position and put him around the right people. But if it's something that he just has a passion for and wants to get, he's gonna get it on his own.
You can always tell when people comment who don't play sports and who does play sports. I think when you know, like when a coach knows that a player is good, they don't just over there dick ride them. You know what I'm saying? Because at that point, you know, they stop being motivated. Did you watch Winning Time?
No.
With the Magic? The
Lakers? I
see it. Okay. So at the beginning, you know, Kareem was a guy. Kareem ain't got to run practices, run laps doing all that shit. He just go out there, he still hit his numbers, but he don't have to be held to an accountable standard. Right. Until Magic come on there and say something to him, and then it's like a whole different – like somebody said something to him and held him accountable.
Yeah.
That's what you're supposed to do. Like you don't let the best player know all the time. You let them know they're getting good and say things to make them keep improving, but you don't do anything to take them away from continuing to work.
Yeah.
And when you do certain things about nepotism, we always want, it's not about the easy way. It's like, if I go and somebody gives me the answers to a test or something, or like a problem for homework, it's going to be cool that I got the A until I get into a situation to where
it has
to be something. Exactly. So then you're going to know that I didn't do it. Okay. Yeah. That's the easy way. And it got me an A, but what if I'm in a situation where I need it? Or let's just say I'm in auto mechanics class. Right. And I have somebody change a tire or do something for a tire for me. That's cool until I blow my damn tire out. Exactly. And we just learned it. So it's not about doing the everything. It's not about not letting people do stuff the easy way. Sometimes we need the knowledge just for general knowledge. I don't use geometry at fucking all. I don't know anybody that's come through using geometry. I ain't never drew a circumference of the ass before I went in. I ain't never used a little triangle shit when I'm out there shooting the ball. I've never done that shit. But it's general knowledge to know certain things about it for when it comes up in conversations, or even if like your kids doing homework, like to get an idea of what they're trying to do. It's just purposeful to always. I'm of the mindset of I'd rather know a little bit of everything than know a bunch of nothing.
Exactly.
So I just feel like I said, and then watching sports and then seeing sports is also taking me into a different realm of like noticing, like I may want to put, you know, Zay, Vizzo, and I want to do them something different because the odds are stacked against them, at least in basketball. They like you got the, it's a rare case now that you've seen a Mikey Williams or Zion Williamson. Yeah. You know, I'm taking it back a little bit. But
even Mikey Williams pops was a hooper, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but even or what's the little one, Hassan? I don't know, I call him Nubsy Bowles, but it's not too often that you see somebody like him because now look at the league. You got Tim Hardaway Jr., Kenyon Martin Jr., you got Zaire Wade, who's on the G League for
Gary Payton II.
You well, got
I don't really count GP because he, you know what I'm saying, he bounced around from team to team.
But you bounce around from teams to teams in the pros.
Yeah, that's true.
So that's what I'm saying. It's filled with a whole bunch of people. You have I don't know. It's a whole bunch of I can't think of all of them off the top of my head, but you have some players like Ken Griffey Jr., Ken Griffey Jr.'s dad. You know what I'm saying? I mean, that's older, but you get what I'm saying. Like when you have these kids, you can get them in, you're always gonna have an unfair advantage to them because they have the access. Like if Serena Williams' daughter ever wanted to play tennis, she is going to fucking kill the competition.
Yeah, but on the other side of that, though, to the same point, look at Michael Jordan's kids. Look at Marcus and Jeffrey Jordan. Now, of the two, Marcus was more talented, but he still didn't make it to the pros.
Yeah, but at the time, what was the pros? The pros was still the pros.
Yeah.
I mean, also at the same time, he was talented, but it's like, okay. So I didn't say them because it's like Bronny and Bryce.
Mm.
And let me know. Okay, so it's like Zaire Wade is cool. Nobody expects Zaire Wade. You don't even really see that much press on him. And he's in the G League. With Bronny, do you know how hard it's going to be after LeBron? Like, there's nothing he can do that they won't say, that won't compare him to his father. So, you know, you get into that realm of Michael Jordan's kids. How the fuck can you live up to Jordan?
You can't.
And I think that was probably why they didn't do is that first kind of mental wave of like too much. Even Shannon Sharpe says all the time, you're not going to be me.
Yeah.
So it's kind of hard to Barry Sanders Jr.'s son was a running back. He ain't make it. He played for the Titans. So but the ease of access for them to come into the league is a lot higher. Yeah.
They already want that spotlight on them.
I'm training this nigga through regular ass coaches. You know what I'm saying? So it's just something I was wondering for nepotism. I think we're doing a better job of setting it up, but I don't think people really pay attention like where we have nepotism at and where we don't. We don't own the cinematography realm. It's Tyler Perry.
Right.
That's it. And Jordan Peele. That's it. Y'all name me somebody else that's popping black and it's Marvel movies. So side note, I saw this. Matt Damon said this on Hot Things. I don't know if you've seen this. So the reason why there's no movies out now that seem like any differences is because that before DVDs went out of style, people would make their money back through DVDs. Streaming services and shit cut all that out.
Yeah.
So now that's why you see a bunch of the same topics going on and on. Oh, I'm sorry. That's why you see a bunch of the same movies being made over and over, and you don't see like any like risk movies or taking a chance like The Notebook or Brokeback Mountain or Moonlight or some shit like that. You know, like you don't see those type you just see kid movies and you see superhero movies.
True.
And a couple of the same action movies because they're not making, so they was like, he was like, if you got an indie film or a regular film like how Matt Damon does and it costs you $20 million to do, you don't spend another $20 million on marketing. That's $50 million. So you really ain't made no money back yet. And what they used to count on, which is why they were able to take more chances, was
it's those hard copy sales. Yeah.
So now that they're not getting that, it's limiting what people are really going to spend their money for. If you're not going to bring in back the money that you're losing or putting in, they're not even going to make it.
Yeah, because for a while, you saw if a movie hit theaters, like a month later, it'll be on Blu-ray. You know what I'm saying? Whereas back in our time when we was coming up, you know, a movie had hit theaters and then it wouldn't hit, you know, the physical copy VHS or DVD until like a year later. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, I get what you're saying.
Hell yeah, bro. You go see the, remember when the Rugrats came out? That shit came out like March. Shit didn't come on DVD, the yellow tape to like
orange, nigga. Orange, nigga. Don't do Nickelodeon like that.
But yeah, that, so it's just nepotism. I just think that we need to realize that we're the generational wealth generation.
Yeah.
And we're the ones setting the stable because we have more access to do stuff than some of our parents. As much as I can't stand that motherfucker Trump, that motherfucker smart. Yeah, I don't know if you've seen he making a burial plot.
He's smart.
He I'm saying he plotted Ivanka on his golf course. Yes. And so now he can claim it like as a burial ground and it's a tax break. Like it's like the motherfucker just you can't even be mad at the motherfucker for like he not doing anything that's not illegal. He always just is in the right position
at the end of the day. He took what was passed down to him and he took full advantage of it. Of the knowledge that he was given, of the money that he was given, he took full advantage of everything he was given by his parents.
Yeah, exactly. So I just like I said, but that's what we need to do is stop complaining about what we don't do and pay attention to what white people are doing. So we're gonna jump into my man Joe, Sleepy Joe. You finally made good on one of those words. So I know if a lot of people don't know, Joe Biden came out and said he's going to do loan forgiveness in two sums, one of 10,000 and one of 20,000. I think if you make under $120,000 or 125, you're going to get 20,000. And if you make less than like 75 or something like that, you get 10,000. Am I right? Or you ain't look?
No, I seen it. I just feel how that meme said, I forgave my loans a long time ago.
Oh, I want that to be known all the time. I just want it to be known that I appreciate you forgiving the loans, Joe. But rest assured, my nigga, I was not paying that shit regardless. Yeah. I'm gonna let you know right now. you're not making money unless you're in debt somewhere. Well,
exactly.
Loans are gonna sit exactly where the fuck they was. And Sally Mae can come over here. She can come over here for a little sweet talk. She can come over there for a little hoochie special. She can come over there for the weed. But I'm definitely not paying none of that loan.
You ain't getting no bread out of me, but no, I'm glad that it's sad that it took this long, but you never know what goes on behind the scenes. But I mean, maybe people can start taking him seriously now. Do I think he's gonna get a second term still?
No,
probably not.
Fuck no. But I do just look. I just like, you know, I'm one of them type of people. What was we getting before? It's like when motherfuckers wanted to complain about the stimulus. Now I understand for the people that can't get the break.
Yeah,
because they make too much. But if I was somebody who couldn't make, like, let's say I made six figures over the amount of money that couldn't give me the 20,000. First off, people are saying 20,000 ain't enough. Motherfucker, that was more than what you had to knock down that motherfucker to begin with. So I'm one of the type of people that be appreciative of what happens or what you get. But
shit, hand me the 10 and that's enough.
Facts. But I wanted to say, like, just I understand the people that make enough and don't get to qualify or even get to use it. I understand their plights, but I will say, like let's not shit on something like what we had before. Exactly. Now the people that was tripping was the Republicans.
That's unconstitutional. One of the people had to pay in the bank and they didn't get a loan. Now,
fuck up, all right?
Man, sit your dumb ass down.
I ain't gonna ask you for that shit. I ain't come through the block. I ain't spin that motherfucker. I ain't turn the lights off. And I rolled down my window and I sat there and told you to come here and ask you for your fucking opinion.
You're right.
Every time. As soon as this Joe coming up there, oh my God, Joe, what is this? This. Shut up.
Man, sit your dumb ass down.
That's exactly how it is. But here's the thing. Don't throw stones at a glass house. So all the people that was complaining about Joe happened to take out PPP loans. So they wanted to benefit where they wanted to cash in where it benefited them, which right. I find very ironic that you're telling people not to do what they can do for this student loan forgiveness. So the White House decided to get up in this petty bag. And then I don't think the Republicans was ready because, the White House had receipts for them. And I know the first thing.
Oh, shit. Here we go again.
Pull it out on their ass. So As the government wants to say any type of debt that was forgiven, Congresswoman Marjorie Taylor had $133,000 in PPP loan that was forgiven. Congressman Matt Gaetz had $482,000 in PPP loans forgiven. After he had to come out here and say, everybody knows that a $60 billion plus European land war is always the last $3 billion that kicks in the door. Congressman, Republican, all these are Republican, by the way.
You're right.
As plumbers and carpenters to pay off loans of Wall Street advisors and lawyers isn't just unfair, it's also bad policy. He forgot to leave out the fact that he also had $987,000 in PPP loans forgiven. And then Mark Wayne Muffley. Yeah, I can kind of get this. Oh, actually, this motherfucker topped the list. Let me see. Yes, two motherfuckers. Mark Wayne Mullen and Kevin Hearn, all Republicans. We do not need farmers, ranchers, and small business owners and teachers in Oklahoma paying the debt of Ivy Leaguers and doctors across the U.S. This place undue burden on those already suffering due to weight of Biden's failed economy policy. And also for Kevin Hearn, to recap, in the last 2 weeks, the party of the people has supercharged the IRS to go after working class Americans, raise their Both y'all can shut the fuck up.
Right.
Because both y'all had $1 million in PPP loans forgiven. So all the Republicans somehow seemed to get real quiet.
Yeah.
When it came down to talking about their shit, which is always the case. And Republicans and all these people are white. But Republicans, you know, this stature always trying to talk about what somebody can and can't do. Yet the law benefits you and your demographic. That's why you pay higher taxes. That's why. But they're always trying to talk about what's unconstitutional, or what's right or wrong. You don't play in the same ball game as regular 9-to-5 people. There's a reason why the PPP loans ran out, because they ran out of money, because motherfuckers like y'all was taking all the money. But yet you're going to tell somebody what to not forgive and what to do for loans. It's fucking trash.
They're getting their shit exposed. It ain't no fun when the rabbit got the gun.
Oh, easily. So, you know, they out here getting exposed and talking all this shit. And, you know, the White House, which I respected for, had time to do some petty. And I felt in my soul that was something I needed to just let be known. So, like you said, don't come out here unless you're ready to load the chopper. And when it bang, bang. In the words,
what they say, a hit dog always gonna holler?
I don't know. But they always say, ain't a pig pussy still pork? Exactly. Go, right? Well, these pig ass niggas need to go ahead and oink oink. Shit. Out of here before we turn their ass to some bacon and some ham. Man. So switching it up. I wanted to ask you, did you hear about the Duke player, Rachel Richardson, that was being racially slurred?
She
was
I seen that it had something to do with like BYU or something like that, but I didn't dive into it.
So I'm going to share like where it has on here. And if you could see it, let me see, share screen. That one. No, I'm going to go over. So I'm going to have it right here. Basically, it's Rachel Richardson. She plays for the Duke volleyball team, and she was playing against BYU at BYU's event. She was going through and doing her progressions, and somebody decided to sit there and say racial slur to her. I guess they called her the N-word.
BYU being in Utah being a place notorious for their professional fans being racist, right?
So if you see it right here, of course, if you see it right here, if you look at her teammates, are looking right before she serves. And if you look at her teammates right about there, they're looking over it if they're saying something. Mm-hmm. Now, the thing I don't like about BYU is when they're doing this type of stuff, it's kind of like they're trying to make it an isolated event, right? And I don't like it. Well, this person didn't go to school at BYU. He's no longer allowed here. And they try to make it seem like racism is an isolated situation. It's really not. And my issue with it all is, like, I don't get why y'all act like these are, like, occurrences that don't happen all the time. Like, y'all make it seem like one to two bad apples are always the one that spoiled a bunch. And it's not that that's the case. Motherfucker, white people are racist. Black people are racist. Motherfuckers is racist.
And somebody before them taught them that that was okay.
So to keep acting like this is isolated events and don't be where you stand for, no, like people know, sir, like black people know if they go to Boston, they probably gonna get something said about them. Like people know certain parts of the U.S. that they go to that's gonna end up in a way that's gonna be for the good or for the bad. I know if I go to Atlanta, I'm gonna feel way more comfortable than if I went to Denmark or something like that. You know what I'm saying? Like Colorado in Aspen. So I just feel like it's a drop of the ball from BYU to just make it seem like this ain't y'all when you know this is your culture. And I find it funny that they're always saying like it's an isolated racial event. No, one motherfucker got caught. They ain't an isolated event. You know what I'm saying? Like, stop acting like y'all don't know what the fuck going on. Y'all so much advanced. That's what got John Gruden ass fired. Isolated event. He was just the one that sent the message. So I just have a problem with.
And you seen, like, coming up with John Gruden, you seen, like, a lot of his players, you know what I'm saying, speaking about him in documentaries and stuff like that. He just finally got outed. You know what I'm saying? So this shit ain't new. You know what I'm saying? This is nothing that nobody's not dealt with before. Like,
I just want to know what it's going to take for us, like, as people, like, or like as a, like, you know, a society to stop acting on some bullshit and acting like we so much further progressed. I don't think we progressed that much further at all. I just think that we have camera phones to where people just can't sit there and act ignorant to the situations. But I also don't think with us having camera phones that is doing anything to help us get any better than what we were before. I still think that we are, like, think about it. How many videos of somebody getting killed or shot by the police should it take for y'all to really stop change if you wanted to? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, they just fired that one cop from Uvalde because he didn't do shit to save them kids. But that ain't nothing new that that people don't care about kids. That's why they don't want to change the gun laws. Look how more serious they get to the gun laws than they do about kids' lives. Like, so it's just when we keep acting ignorant, I feel like you're worse than the racist because, or people that are racist, because you're acting as if you didn't have any idea. Like, I don't, do you watch Harry Potter, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So do you remember in the prisoner, no, not the prison, the Order of the Phoenix, when they were going and they was calling Dumbledore all type of liars and shit that Voldemort wasn't back. And the Minister of Magic kept saying over and over and over again, Dumbledore is a liar. He's trying to take over the ministry. Voldemort isn't back.
And then he told
you all this. And yeah, he come down the thing at night, see Voldemort standing over there. And then that's when he wants to believe it. And I feel like that it's was like a
been telling one. You this has been going on.
Exactly. And if you think about it, like JK does a good job of doing that when she like puts shit in perspective. And I just think that like we need to stop with this bullshit. I ain't gonna hold it too much on that one because I know these last two are gonna be probably lengthy for us. I had a question for you. I was thinking about something the other day, and I need you to tell me. Who do you think has had the better actor musician career, and would you say is more iconic than the other? Jamie Foxx, and you have Will Smith. And I was sitting there thinking, and you know, off rip, because of popularity, everybody's immediate answer is to say
Will Smith.
Okay, so you get that, and then you had to really sit back there and think. But I was watching the movie The Day Shift on Netflix, and I was watching it,
it was hard, by the way.
I liked it. As I was watching, I was like, Jamie Foxx has his range. Now, again, he done put out some poo too. But when you think about him and Will Smith, it's like five really Will Smith movies that you can go to. It's Ali, Bad Boys 1, Bad Boys 2, Hitch, and that whole 7 Pound shit, I guess. You know what I'm saying? But like, if you watch Independence Day, he wasn't really a star in that.
Okay. You missing Pursuit of Happiness.
Hold on. I hated that movie. But that shit was just depressing. Like, that shit like irritated the fuck out of me. Like how depressing that shit was. But I wanted to do a side by side. You know what I'm saying? Like, we're going to go through and I'm going to say them both. And I want you to tell me when you really think about it, who had the better career. Cause they both act and sing. And on top of that, when's the last time, like, all y'all niggas really do is just listen to Summertime at one time of the year in the summer. Now, nah. Fall, October, and all this shit, ain't nobody playing. Yeah, no, you're not. But you can blame it on alcohol from January to December.
No, music. Some
of y'all can blame it on alcohol, kids. Some of y'all getting out, blaming on alcohol, penicillin. So what I'm saying is, you niggas been blaming on alcohol for a long ass time. I'm just like, you know, and you know, y'all been falling for that type for a long time. But all I'm saying is, I ain't gonna lie. Get jiggy with it, not you know. What is it? Here come the men in black.
I'll say music wise, Jamie Foxx got it.
The one that you remember.
Yeah, man, fuck that. Oh, don't forget about the Wild Wild West with Cisco.
No, nah, man, I can't because I can't remember. Going straight.
To the wild, wild. All bullshit aside, music wise, Jamie Foxx got it hands down.
You trying to say the Men in Black don't do it for you? No.
Me personally, I'm more of a fan of Will Smith than Jamie Foxx, but I'm also a realist.
So I wanted to do this, right? So I'm going to go down the list.
Okay.
Or both of them. We're going to do Jamie Foxx first. And we're going to just start the movies where, like, you really just know. Because, you know, everybody been in the movie, you ain't know. Like, when Will Smith played that gay character, I'm really mad my light keep going off. But when Will Smith played that gay character, yeah, that was all him. So let's see. We got Jamie Foxx first. We got Booty Call, Players Club, Any Given Sunday, Held Up, Bait, Ali, Mad That My Light Keep Going Off, Shade, Breaking All the Rules, Collateral, Ray, Stealth. I know he wish he could throw that shit away.
Right.
He the only nigga that died too. I'm still not over that. Like, Jamie, how the fuck did you sign up for some shit where you the only motherfucker that died in the whole movie called Stealth? And then on top of that, your death was so dumb. Like, they tell you not to take your eyes off the road at all times, and somehow you the nigga that run into the wall. But anyways, you got Jarhead, Miami Vice. This is starting when it start to go down, people. You got Dreamgirls picked it back up. Dreamgirls, Kingdom, Elmo, Countdown, Law Abiding Citizen, Valentine's Day, Due Date, I'm Still Here, Rio, Horrible Bosses, The Django, Classic, White House Down, Rio, Amazing Spider-Man 2, Rio 2, I'm sorry, Horrible Bosses 2, A Million Ways to Die in the West. Hold on. Django, A Million Ways to Die in the West was a two. He was the Django in two movies.
I haven't seen A Million Ways to Die.
It said cameo role. So it must be a Quentin Tarantino thing. But Annie, Sleepless, Welcome to My Life, Baby Driver, Bullshit, Project Power. I kind of like that one. Bullshit, Soul, Love Soul, Spider-Man No Way Home, and then Day Shift, right? Now, let's go to Willard. Mr. Keep My Wife's Name Out Your Motherfucking Mouth. Well,
put the show in there, too. Put the Jamie Foxx show in there,
I was going to say that in general. Like, you still got the shows that you can add. But, I mean, I like the Fresh Prince better, like Jamie Foxx show.
Absolutely.
So, I think that also would catapult some, too, if people don't be taken into consideration. But let's go ahead and get, and I'm really mad about how my light keep cutting off, but we'll work through it. Let's see. Will Smith or Willard, Mr. Slap You at the Grammys, Mr. Bow, bitch. Say something else about Jada if you want to. That's my bald head, all right? So let's see. Willard, what's
Mr.
your...
Mr. Entanglement,
Bow, get your ass off Jada. You ain't slap August like that. And then Chris Rock, I got this. Unless you listen to the show, Chris Rock, then I definitely support everything that happened to you. This nigga is a monster. We need to get him off the streets. But for the nigga that got slapped by the softest rapper, and you must be the softest comedian, because nigga, they fought back. You know what I'm saying? Fuck them cameras. Okay, let's see. 6 Degrees of Separation, Bad Boys, which Bad Boys 2 is one of the rare cases where the second movie is better than the first. Men in Black, Independence Day, niggas don't pay attention. He was not the star of Independence Day. Enemy of the State, Wild Wild West, The Legend of Sadder Vance, but Bagger Vance for the niggas that really know the name. Ali, don't remember what Showtime. Oh, that's a movie with Eddie Murphy. So they both had been in a movie with Eddie Murphy before. Anyway. Yeah. Oh, no, he was just a producer of Showtime. Okay, so he wasn't in that. Men in Black 2, which was okay. Men in Black, a Bad Boys 2, favorite movie. Damn. When I get my next partner, that's how you shoot. All right. Ride or Die, Jersey Girl. No. I, Robot, one of my favorite Will Smith movies. Right. Period. I don't even know why I didn't say that. Seat Filler, Saving Friends. This shit starts. Shark Tales, sure. Hitch. He produced ATL. I didn't know that. Pursuit of Pitifulness. All right. Grown ass man. Look, I'm gonna say this real quick, okay? Before I go to this, you're a grown ass man sleeping on the bathroom. All right. That is the most pitiful I've ever. I cannot get that image of how dirty this nigga looked. Will Smith has never been the same to me since I've seen this nigga's mustache. Like, it's the worst. He has one of the most iconic memes I've ever seen. Like, one of his face gotta be the most pitiful shit, bro.
Why was your mustache so sweaty?
Bro, like, why? Why did you bite? And then on top of that, bro, like, what kind of father are you? You know what I'm saying? Like, you just got this little ass boy sleeping. Then you didn't even have the decency to cover him up in paper towels, you petty son of a bitch. Like, what the fuck is no? You selling bone density readers. Like, they gave this bullshit script and said, who the fuck want to play somebody selling bone density? At least Antoine Fisher got touched or something. Like, nigga, something with some real sadness. You know what I mean? Like, come on now.
Book hey, of man, Eli. It was still a true Eli, story,
Book
man.
Of Eli, Book of Eli, Denzel was blind. All right? This nigga walking around with a Braille Helen Keller book the entire time. The Bible. Nigga, and you know what's crazy? Nigga could have been lying. Like, that could have had three pages from the Bible on it and then put the cover of a hard Bible in there and then somebody switched it with Braille porn. Like, come on now. Like, and then Lazarus and Jesus came through with Mary and then he got older, the titties slipped out of the bra. What the fuck? Kind of chapter? What part of the Bible is this?
That took a turn.
You talking about this Pursuit of Happiness? No. Bro, I'm just, oh, you talking about the Bible? Hell yeah. Hold on. Will Smith. Pursuit. I got okay. Don't laugh at me because I spelled pursuit with a P-E-R. But
come on, man.
This shit right here, bro. Oh, come on, don't do that to me. Let me see. Where is that? Did he give it to me? This gotta be the saddest fucking meme. I hate this motherfucking face. I'ma send this so y'all can just see. Look at this.
Hey, that's
shit.
Worse than this is crying, the man. Most
pitiful face I've ever seen in my life. I hate this shit with a passion. I'll never forgive him. Doing that bullshit, okay. I just as good as it did. I'd rather take him dying his dumb ass off in the tub on 7 pounds, just harvests his own organs doing some dumb. She needs some eyes, she need a toenail, she needs some elbow grease. Like, what the fuck is this? No, anyways, okay. I Am Legend. That was a little too weird. He was trying to fuck a dog.
That was, I would say that's probably his most difficult movie to act
or watch.
No, the most difficult one to watch was the one with him and Jaden.
Hancock.
Oh, shit. Here we go again.
That's every time. And Hancock was just some bullshit. Like, he was in there in jail, can jump over the shit. Then he like, oh, I think my people was this. And when we fall in love, we lose our powers because we horny. The fuck out. But if I go 100 feet away, you know what I'm saying? I love you, but my bitch really got a whole family, you know, but I love you. And then you hit me upside the head with a frying pan. I lost my nerve and came back. The bullet was out me. Come on.
I actually like Hancock. I hate it After Earth.
After Earth, I would have asked for a divorce from my parents. That's when I knew something was up with, that's when I knew something was up with Jaden Smith. You know what I'm saying? Like, you was kind of overacting in Karate Kid. But nigga, you was doing the most. I hate it here. Well, fight back then, bitch. Got nigga do uppercut. But
hey, but Jaden Smith also shifted the culture with that. I hate it here though, because you won't find nobody that ain't saying that. But man, we digress.
And then After Earth with this bullshit, bring me to where you at. I don't know what the fuck is this? This is Wakanda, but before Wakanda. Anyways, Karate Kid, Men in Black 3, After Earth, Anchorman 2. That was just a cameo.
Men in Black 3 was fire.
I forgot. Which one was Oh, that's when he went back in time. Which one was
it was when he found out that K was actually his
was his dad's partner or something like that.
Focus was actually good. At a certain point, he just hated being American because concussion. Tell her the truth. Tell her the truth. All right, nigga, I got a concussion. God damn, bro. Take your ass on, bro. He work at Vanderbilt Pediatrics, nigga. Don't be coming over here. Suicide Squad, I thought he was actually good. But yeah, it's kind of hard. Like, unlike the second Suicide Squad with Idris, we're getting sidetracked. I'm going to say this. After the second Idris, like, it's hard to take Will Smith out of anything. He's bigger than any role he plays. True. I'm sorry. That's why it's hard to take him serious in some of these other things. But Aladdin, that movie sucked, but he kind of made it. Gemini Man, I actually thought that was better than
Gemini Man was redemption for After Earth, because After Earth was just trash.
But then the second and third time I watched it, it got stupid. Bad Boys for Life, old niggas, retirement. That's what it should have been called. King Richard is good, but he at the appropriate age to play King Richard, because he looked like Pursuit of Happiness, and then now Vincent Williams. Man, get your ass on. So, anyways, but King Richard was a good movie. So now we bring it back to who's more iconic? Who's a better one? You got 1A, you got 1B. I spent so much time looking at this bullshit Will did that I just forgot that Jamie was even in the running. Like, that mustache on Happiness really threw me off my groove. But I ask you, King, who do you say is the more iconic out of the two?
Out of the two, see, I gotta separate the music from the movies. Because music-wise, Jamie Foxx been doing that shit. Like, he's way more talented than Will Smith was on the movie, on the music side. Movies, it kind of goes to what you prefer, because you can't really say that Will Smith used every part of his talent in his movies. He always played, for the most part, a more serious role, or had more serious films. Jamie mm-hmm. Foxx then gave you comedies and drama. And action, but movie wise, and I'm gonna give it to Will Smith, just because every single one, it's like, not to compare him to Hov, but it's like Hov now. Will is more on the grown man side of his movie making, whereas Jamie Foxx will still give you a comedy.
You put a homeless man in the fucking bathroom. All right, you should.
You asked me a question and I'm answering.
I didn't say you was wrong. I'm just saying I don't agree. But
I would say,
tell the truth. That's what I need you to do. Tell the truth. Tell the truth. That's what you agree with. You going with James? You going with Wilson? Tell the truth.
Hey man, I'm gonna give it to Will Smith on the movie side. Now, if you're putting them both together, then Jamie edges him because of edges.
That's a pause. Said. That's what the street said. Everything is a pause. And I actually had to pause this interview as soon as you said, "What's up?"
I'll say I'll give it to Jamie if you just making it collective with the music and the movies together. I would give it to Jamie. I would say he's had. I would say he's had more of a stamp, especially with Django. Like, you know what I'm saying? He's a fucking black superhero of black superheroes.
nigga made you want to be a slave. Shit. Whoa, nigga. Lock me up, nigga. This
had me thinking, see, that's like the shit I would have been doing if I was a slave.
Exactly. All y'all niggas keep talking about what y'all is and ain't gonna do. Shit. Okay.
Man, I'm going with Jamie. All it takes is one.
I'm going with Jamie.
I'm just biased towards Will, but I would say that he had just as solid of a career as Will Smith.
I think I'm gonna give it to Jamie. I think Jamie can do more roles than Will. I think Will's kind of, it's like Denzel. Denzel plays Denzel playing a character in every movie. Like, my son won't bury me. My son, I will not bury my son. My son will bury me. Wait, huh? Oh, you sons of bitches. Oh, you gonna do this?
You shot me in the ass. Oh, motherfucker.
You'll be playing basketball in Pelican Bay. I'll be landing this plane in Pelican Bay. I'm going to equalize you in Pelican Bay. My son won't bury me in Pelican Bay.
Down the Bongo. Down the Bongo. Bang, bang.
All right, can you be John Q, not Denzel? Please, nigga, can you play somebody that we play? I'll read the Braille in Pelican Bay.
But like, if I'm comparing, you know, the Fresh Prince to the Jamie Foxx show,
and that's not even a competition. Like, that's right. The one thing. That's what I'm saying. Like,
but that's what I'm saying. Like, Will, it depends on what you prefer. You know what I'm saying? Because Will gonna hit you. You know what I'm saying? In your emotions.
That nigga's going to ask you to tell the truth. That's what he's going to look at you. That's why I'm gonna name this episode. I told the truth.
I give it to a both because they both can be funny and serious in the same film. You know what I'm saying?
I think Will Smith is funny as a person, but I think they don't put him in roles where he shows his range. He's sitting on the floor crying, telling bone density scan. Y'all know who I pick. So I'm not even going to go on those spills so we get to this last topic.
It just depends on what you
got. Tell the truth.
Because at the same time, you got Jamie Foxx within Living Color and what he did with that show. Wanda is iconic.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I heard back in the day you said you wanted to fuck.
Chill, bro. You gotta relax.
Whoa. Hey, look.
Here you go with that shit.
He's like, them lips, though? Shoot, that's Jamie.
Here you go with this shit, man.
Fuck, hey, you know that remind me of
the fuck is wrong with
that,
you?
That scene in Atlanta where he was like, no, this is my girl, man. She was like, man, that ain't no girl. Nigga, that's a man. You know what I mean? She over here in the lockup with all the men. If she was a woman, she'd be over there with the woman.
Hey, he made that nigga think for a second. He's like,
he was like, hold up, what's that? He was like, that ain't gay. Nah, see, you was fucking niggas on the outside. Niggas get fucked on the inside. That ain't gay. You was fucking niggas by choice on the outside. But let me get to the last
one. That's still gay.
Yes. But coming through, she walked through that jail cell.
I peeped the ass out and I was like, damn, she thick as fuck. Turn around, TT. I was like, damn, nigga, what you doing out here with all this ass?
Man, rest in peace, Teddy,
boy. That's how he came in that jail, boy. Double cheeked up. That's what you usually say about Wanda. But so the last topic I got, Diddy put out some shit that said he feels like R&B is dead. I don't disagree, but I wanted to have your take on it. Do you feel like today's R&B is dead compared to its predecessors? Or do you feel like that's an ageism word because of the generation that they were in, not getting on board to the new generation?
I would say R&B don't feel the same. I wouldn't say it's dead. I would say that it could be better, but R&B would never be dead as long as Tank is alive. You know what I'm saying? R&B, you got
Tank lost a lot of niggas when he was talking about he was scooting his butt cheeks up to the end of the bed.
I listen to the music. I don't. I ain't got nothing to do with what that man do behind his closed doors.
I love the way you eat my booty, and you know what to do when you're in.
Now, there are pieces of R&B that are dead. R&B groups, dead.
Begging for some pussy, dead. Call a girl out her name, dead. I remember when I seen this bitch, she ass is so thick and she want the dick. Whoa, nigga, what the fuck, nigga? What the fuck is you speaking, bro? Like, how can I play this in front of my moms, my nigga? Like, what the fuck? She was bouncing on them toes, about to give my balls a roll, and I was like, oh, nigga, what about this is romantic, huh?
Oh, man.
Do you remember, what was it? Throat Baby. Oh, no, hell no. Shorty got the best head in the world, don't she?
Bro, no.
She be ready to stick with my lip in her eyes. She swirl on it.
Speaking of Throat Baby, bro.
Whoa.
Speaking of that.
Do I put a censor on this?
No, speaking of that song, and I'm sure you've probably come across it, being that Vizzo is a baby about the same age as Cash. I'm sure you come across that song on YouTube, that kid's song that they modeled after Throw Baby.
I don't want to.
Bro.
Do not send me that song. If I can't, because I still be black. But no, don't send me that song.
I will send it to you.
Mommy got the best tits in the world, don't she? I be ready for milk. Put her nipples on my lips and I swear on it.
lyrically,
hey, bro, like, what the fuck is this? Mommy's titties. I'm trying to drink from you, baby. Come on,
lyrically is not the same, but melodically, it's the exact same as Throat Babies. But it's just since you know Throat Babies as a song, it just make you not want to listen to me.
So you the baby that made it. I lost my brothers, and I'm about to drink this milk, boo.
But no, bro, like, pieces of R&B are dead. Like we said, R&B groups, you know what I'm saying? Rest in peace to Gerald LaVert. We'll never have another Gerald LaVert.
One of y'all niggas call me that name again, all right?
I didn't.
I ain't talking about that. I'm just saying, Nick, were you talking to Gerald LaVert? Nothing. This ain't no LSG. My body all over your body, baby.
I personally would have gave you early Freddie Jackson, not Gerald LaVert, but you know, that's me.
You are my lady. Oh boy, see, it's gonna be bad when a nigga playing what they playing. I can't think of a song that's like wild thoughts, and the nigga out there like, hey, you young niggas don't know nothing about this. Hey, yeah, see, that pretty wicked era is gone, you know. It's 5 in the morning.
But see,
ready to get like you. Oh, hold how the dance go. And now I'm on the hotline over here, lusting for you.
See, that's the light skin shit I be talking about. This is why you're not brown skin. This
see
is
the lust in your eyes. I know you can't fight it. And that walk in your vibe makes me wanna try it. Sorry.
You done? Yeah. You got a little bit more. Go on, let it out.
Go ahead.
Don't let it out. Express yourself.
Go ahead, King. You're a stallion, baby. You know you got body. You working that thing. I can make it juicy for you.
Yeah.
I can make it juicy. Ain't nobody seen Usher no more. What happened to Superstar?
See, yeah, you still got Usher. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, R&B is not dead. I would just say it's not what it used to be. We'll never have another Jagged Edge. We'll never have another Drew Hill.
Niggas ain't getting married.
By the way.
Niggas ain't getting married. Side note, that was a horrible song when you think about the lyrics. That and that next song is just, we should get with meet me at the altar in your white dress. I ain't got no more bitches, so we might as well do it. I done dip my dick in everything that's wet. Now, girl, let's just get married. Girl, let's just get married.
I ain't got nothing else to do.
Exactly. Shit. I ain't watching TV. The Titans don't play.
Even on the second verse, he said, so I done it all.
You are all my hot. See, that shit was smooth, though. Like, the last good R&B song was Loyal. And that shit was horrible. When a rich nigga wants you. Won't you, baby? Bruh. But no, you know what's funny?
I wouldn't count that as R&B just because it's Chris Brown. That's more of his pop.
Breezy. No, hey, look, how old were you when you realized that next song, Stop Dancing, Getting a Little
Close. I knew we wasn't supposed to be singing that as kids.
Well, you was a little nasty. That's you Gary niggas. That's when y'all be having kids at 12.
First of all, I'm not from Gary.
Boy, please. You from Gary?
I'm not from Gary.
Oh, okay. What was I about
to say? Don't lie to your fans like that. Ain't nothing wrong with Gary, but I'm not.
No, he said, fuck Gary. You hear that? Huh? He said, fuck Gary. I was just like, whoa.
Anywho.
So what you think it needs to be done to get back to that era? Do you feel like they don't even believe in the same values of love?
I feel like people need to take the Brent Fires route and just sing about what they go through.
Ain't nobody trying to hear that goddamn therapy, mental
shit. I'm not saying model your music after him. I'm saying be true to who you are as an artist. You know what I'm saying? Don't try to make what's popular. Make
the lyrics. Go ahead.
Make what people can relate to. You know what I'm saying?
The lyrics to Stingy goes, how's it go? Fuck, I can't go.
Please forgive me. I'm just stingy, but how can you blame me?
Oh yeah, but what's the verse before that? Anyways, let's go to Genuine Differences. My whole life has changed since you've been here. I know.
Oh, you mean the backup singer, the background dancer in the Thriller?
Yes, yeah, that nigga. But I just couldn't get it. I just see like the lyrics of what they did. What Cisco? Even though it seems I have everything, I don't want to be a lonely fool. all of the women, all of the expensive cars, none of it amount to you. Shit. What is it? Case. Couldn't we be happily ever after?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Joe, I want to know. He want to know.
Case and he want to know he can be in a broken glass.
I was on that one too, but he want to know how to be a side nigga. So I just think that, like, I think that R&B, I don't think R&B is dead. I think just like old raps when niggas was sounding like Slick Rick and off slow, and when the tone changed from New York rap to down south rap, and people said that ain't really hip hop because, you know, they say, I don't know what the baby says.
But it is.
It is, of course. That's what I'm saying. Same with Thug. I think it's just in a transition, but I think that the reason why R&B is dead is because how the dating scene is.
Yeah. I would say, I still wouldn't say it's dead. I would just say it's not as relevant.
I mean, niggas ain't trying to sing. Like, even look at the R&B singers who like rappers.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, don't nobody look soft. You know what I'm saying? Everybody looks like a rapper on autotune. I just think that, like I said, when you look at the values of what people date, you know, now versus what they did before, people, you know, women know they value. They talking about City Girl shit or Megastain. Ah, you know, that type shit. And it's just, and with guys, it's kind of like, I feel like a lot of guys hurt. They ain't about to keep going through hurt shit. No more. Right. They ain't about to suck. They ain't about to do it. But all they talking about is like fucking.
Right.
And don't act like ain't certain Isley Brothers, like Between the Sheets. So ain't like it ain't fucking songs out there.
Oh man, you R&B back in the day had its today shit going on too. Yeah. Luther Vandross got the Sneaky Link anthem.
Hell yeah, shit.
If only for one night.
And then you don't want to be singing who Luther was singing for. But I don't know if you want to use that. So. They said about Luther, I don't know if you want to be singing who was that
what
one
he,
night.
What do you think? I won't tell a soul.
Exactly. You see, Kevin Campbell just came out, which that wasn't even like a shocker. You that know what I'm saying? Impressive. But I'm just saying, you don't want to. Well, Luther was having for one night. You might not want to be singing them lyrics. But
yeah, like, funny as fuck.
I'm just looking at like Summer Walker, like Come Through. But I do notice the only time they can really do like retro R&B is when they hop on an old beat.
Yeah.
Like if they do their own beats, it's not the same.
Yeah. Cause even Tank nowadays, he would sample a lot of old R&B, but like I said, he's still a true R&B artist to the core. You know what I'm saying? He never tried to rap or nothing like that.
Yeah. So like I just don't, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can't hear you now.
I didn't say anything while you was talking, but I was making sure. I just think that, like I said, the intentions aren't the same. So yeah. I think that's it.
It's different content. I don't think it's dead. You know what I'm saying? But it is different.
Life support. Yeah. It's on life support.
Nah, I don't
like the aspect is still like fucking. So I guess that's, you know, rhythm and blues is really about really beating. That's what R&B stands for. Like you really
getting some rhythm, as they were saying in the 90s. So.
But like I said, I think it's a cool place to wrap it. I appreciate my dog coming on today, my fam.
Appreciate being here.
Of course, man. Like I said, the solo ones are cool, but it is cool to chop it up and talk to people. So you got any words to end by? Any reflective things that you been going through or want to say that you been doing, or you got any sound offs?
This is kind of random, but it's relevant. Real fathers exist, man. You know what I'm saying? Shout out to all the new parents. Shout out to my best friend who's due to pop any day now. You know what I'm saying? You said what?
The best friend. I was like, appreciate it. Oh, it wasn't.
Talking about my best friend, Jenna, man. My female best friend. But no, man. Whatever you believe in, man, believe in it. Don't let nobody shake you from your beliefs, man. And with that being said, Will Smith is still better than Jamie Foxx.
Man, sit your dumb ass down.
I was about to do a high clap, but you had to end it on that bullshit. Hey, I appreciate y'all coming through and checking us out. Shout out to everybody still doing it. Shout out to Pork L Cool Out Corner, my dogs Irv and Weeks back on the Black to the Basic Brandon for I'm Just Saying podcast, Frocast with the Frocast podcast, Rodis. I already said earlier, but shout them back out again. Dolomite from the Too Much Game podcast, Lamp, So Problematic, Picture Worth a Thousand Words, Linnell. My Ace Boon Coons. I want to shout out to Drew Versus the World. My homie Ace Boon again. Daniel from Girl What Podcast. It's a whole bunch of them. I know I'm gonna forget some. So shout out to everybody else. And I'd say I'm gonna make a list every time, and I don't. But make sure y'all check out this. Make sure y'all like, share, and subscribe. Keep them numbers rolling. Irv, stop getting my videos blocked. Appreciate everybody for coming through. And if you, when you say, you know, King,
I got one more thing. Shout out to you for how your show has grown, man, since it started. Shout out to you and your network, and you know what I'm saying, just your way to connect with people, man. I've been seeing the growth, you know what I'm saying. I don't catch every episode, but the ones I do catch, man, I can tell that you get better with every episode, man. So shout out to you. I'm giving you your flowers now as my brother.
I appreciate that, man.
This is why people don't do this shit.
Thank you, bro. You said you giving me mine. I can't sit there and get a round of applause. Niggas got to make it to where it's beneficial to them. So make sure y'all check out.
Take your bow, man.
Thank you. People, make sure y'all check out the YouTube page. Like, share, and subscribe. Send it out to everybody. Make sure y'all check us out on Apple, Spotify, iHeart, Google Playlist. Everything. I'm all around. Worldwide. Since it is winter, I guess since I did put them out late, I'm gonna put them out on time this time. So make sure y'all check out the site once I finish editing it and put the taxes in, since they want to charge a nigga their taxes for a business. Make sure y'all get the pullovers, the hoodies, hats, everything. 8 More Than 92 Podcast.
I was about to say the merch is fire too.
Thank you, I appreciate that. We kind of could not find no hoochie, so y'all gonna have to wait till later. Unless y'all want some wintertime hoochies, but we got some hoochie sweats, you know what I'm saying?
About to say the gray sweats.
When it exactly, hey, bring it in and pull out prints. We got print polos, you know what I'm saying? So everybody want them. Shout out to everybody, you know. And when you say King Harrison, King Hooch, make sure you put the biggest on that motherfucker. So we're gonna holler at y'all later. Peace. Hey. And like, did you just poop, nigga?
Yeah, I did. That motherfucker here too.
Hey bro, I'm leaving that shit in.
Harrison.
Bang, 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 bang.
Honestly, I think I can fuck with a motherfucker like you.
Hoochie.
See, I don't like a motherfucker that be all on me.
It's the 8 1 and 92 Podcast, where we always keep it 100.
Show me one!
You know how we do.
Give me 100.
Hoochie.